In this video, we're going to talk about gradient potentials and their ability to be additive on target neurons. In this case, the target neuron here being this larger one in pink. And what we have is, in our sort of artificial scenario here, is presynaptic neurons that are synapsing on it. Okay, that's one way in which gradient potentials can be generated. Another, we can open other types of channels that are opened by something other than neurotransmitter. For instance, mechanically gated channels or chemically gated channels. So this isn't the only scenario that gradient potentials can be generated. But let's continue on and talk about how they can be additive. And so in this scenario, the first scenario here in A, we have the presynaptic neuron X releasing neurotransmitter and generating a depolarization. That change in membrane potential is going to cause electrotonic current that will change the voltage, the membrane potential, at distant regions, including possibly the axon initial segment right here. And again, we care about this region the most because that is where we either reach or don't reach threshold of the voltage-gated channels to initiate a nerve impulse. So, if this synapse due to neuron X here becomes active and releases neurotransmitter in response to a single nerve impulse, we would get an excitatory postsynaptic potential, right? And it's excitatory because it's a depolarization. That is excitatory. A depolarization is excitatory because that gets us closer to the threshold of our voltage-gated channels over here where we have our voltmeter. Now, what we could have happen, though, is multiple nerve impulses traveling along this presynaptic neuron, releasing neurotransmitter multiple times sequentially. And because our excitatory potential doesn't dissipate instantaneously, they can be additive over time, right? Generating a larger stimulatory input. That is due to what we call temporal summation. Temporal meaning in time, summating, meaning adding together. And so what we're doing is we're adding together multiple little EPSPs to generate one larger EPSP, which again would be more likely to generate or to reach threshold over here at our axon initial segment. In the second scenario here in B, we're now going to look at two separate presynaptic neurons being active. And remember, it could be hundreds or thousands, so we've got a highly simplified picture here. But in this simple version, we've got them both being stimulatory, both generating depolarizations, right? And so if we have one of them being active, we get an EPSP. The other one being active, since it's also stimulatory, generating an EPSP, right? They don't have to be the same size. They could be different distances from the axon initial segment. They could be more channels, more neurotransmitter. It could be a lot of things that can make them different sizes. But if they happen at the same time, the net effect on the cell is going to be larger. In other words, they are going to add in space, which is known as spatial summation, right? And our overall effect here would be, with X and Y active, would be a larger stimulatory response. In the final panel, now we're looking at neuron X being active, again generating an EPSP, but now neuron Z being active, and note that this is inhibitory because it's generating a hyperpolarization, probably due to potassium flux. And so if we look at them individually, here's our EPSP from X, here's our IPSP, right, due to Z because it's inhibiting the neuron by making it taking it farther from the threshold of voltage-gated channels. If they were both active at the same time and equal and opposite in their magnitudes, nothing would happen. And of course, if one was large, if EPSP was larger, we'd get a little depolarization. If the IPSP was larger, we'd get a little hyperpolarization. And again, the whole idea here is to keep in mind that our inputs are continuous. They are often in opposition. It's not always stimulatory or inhibitory. It can be both. And that they're additive both in time and in space, temporal and spatial.